The dispute between the elder groups and the youth intensified, nearing the independence of Indonesia. The conflict worsened when the news of Japan's defeat spread all over the country. On August 15, 1945, coinciding with Japan's surrender to the Allies, the youth from various political ideologies urged an immediate proclamation. However, Sukarno gave no response, even though he had been urged and threatened by the youth several times. Like Sukarno, Hatta and the other nationalists did not seem to be moved to proclaim the independence immediately. The youth considered it as an inaction, their disappointment often translated into some radical actions.
Nah, kelompok nasionalis tua itu berpikir bahwa mereka akan menggunakan struktur yang sudah diberikan oleh pemerintah Jepang selepas dari janji Perdana Menteri Koiso untuk memberikan kemerdekaan kelak di kemudian hari. Dan bagi kelompok nasionalis tua, pembentukan badan usaha persiapan kemerdekaan itu semacam sebuah konsolidasi kekuatan dari berbagai macam wilayah di Indonesia.
Chairul Saleh was a member of the radical youth at that time. He had no reservations in accusing the old leaders in the Committee of Nine for decelerating independence. To him, independence must be declared immediately to avoid Japanese intervention.
Karena baginya, kepalahan Jepang itu seharusnya bisa menjadi momentum penting untuk memproklamirkan kemerdekaan Indonesia. Dan menurut Chairul juga, kemerdekaan Indonesia itu seharusnya dicapai sendiri dan bukanlah pemberian dari Jepang. Dan dirinya teguh dengan prinsip-prinsipnya tersebut dan sempat terlibat dalam perdebatan sengit dengan Bung Karno dan juga Bung Hatta.
Syahrir also shared the same opinion when he insisted Sukarno to declare the proclamation script that he arranged. Syahrir was desperate since Sukarno denied his effort. He doubted that the independence was a gift from the Japanese. The true mastermind behind the Rengas Dengklok incident at the dawn of August 16, 1945 was uncertain. The incident became the milestone of Indonesia's independence. Sukarno, Hatta, and the other leaders were abducted by the youth and taken to Rengas Dengklok under the pretext of rescuing them from distress, since the spirit of revolution had been ignited all over town.
Tidak ada data yang jelas ya siapa yang menyiapkan, tapi semua mengacu kepada asrama Menteng Raya 31 gitu. Jadi otomatis sebenarnya menunjuk kepada Chairul Saleh dan Sukarni ya yang merancang penculikan tersebut, walaupun dalam aksinya nanti yang menjalankan proses penculikan itu bukannya Chairul Saleh tetapi Sukarni bersama Ikana dan lain-lain. Sementara kelompok yang dipimpin oleh Chairul Saleh itu tugasnya adalah pergi ke dalam kota Jakarta dan menghubungi simpul-simpul organisasi pemuda untuk bersiap melakukan keributan ya, kalau perlu membuat semacam pemberontakan.
Chairul Saleh was strongly suspected as the initiator of the abduction. However, the revolution story created by the youth to arouse a sense of emergency so that the proclamation had to be done immediately never actually happened. Even when Sukarno, Hatta, and the other leaders were brought back to Jakarta at the night.
Sehingga ada jokes gitu, ada lelucon ketika Sukarno, Hatta itu dijemput pulang dari Rengas Dengklok. Ada Sukarno ikut di dalamnya, terus Sukarno bilang, lihat bu, ada asap besar di kejauhan, itu tandanya revolusi sudah dimulai. Kemudian mobil jalan terus dan melewati sumber asap itu yang ternyata adalah petani sedang membakar jerami. oh rupanya ini revolusi yang kamu bilang katanya, dan memang tidak pernah terjadi revolusi.
Proklamasi. Kami, bangsa Indonesia, dengan ini menyatakan kemerdekaan Indonesia.
Independence was finally declared, even though it was prepared in such rush just one night at the house of Admiral Tadashi Maeda, where the script was composed. A day after the proclamation, Chairul Saleh still objected and denied its contents. Chairul Saleh continued to become the youth figure who was fully discontent with the way independence was acquired by the old nationalists. However, the same disappointment fueled a sense of nationalism after the independence. Chairul Saleh consolidated the youth under the Indonesian Youth Alliance, which later became Komite Van Acti. The committee that enforced the Ikada gathering on September 19, 1945. The giant meeting that saw more than 3,000 people rallying the streets, sparking seizure of power and assets from the Japanese.
Saya minta saudara-saudara diam semua.
Justru yang dilakukan oleh Chairul Saleh itu memanfaatkan institusi Sedenbu ini. Misalnya
Chairul Saleh was born in Sawah Lunto, West Sumatra on September 13, 1960. His father was Ahmad Saleh and his mother was Zubaidah binti Ahmad Marzuki. They divorced when Chairul was still 2 years old. His father was a doctor who wanted Chairul Saleh to follow his footsteps as a doctor.
Tapi Chairul Saleh itu menjawab dengan nada mengejek bahwa dia tidak mau jadi dokter karena tidurnya akan terganggu nanti kalau lagi tidur enak-enak gitu, malam-malam dibangunin disuruh ngebantu orang melahirkan, suruh ngebantu orang korban kecelakaan.
His father provided him with good education. Chairul initiated his school at Europesh Lahore School or ELS in Bukit Tinggi. After graduating, he moved to Medan, North Sumatra to follow his father and then entered HBS Medan. In 1934, he moved to Jakarta to get his law degree.
Dan di Batavia inilah jiwa politik Chairul semakin terasa. Jadi ia kerap berdiskusi dan berinteraksi dengan para tokoh pergerakan yang berasal dari berbagai latar belakang politik. Dan ia termasuk juga dalam Pemuda Menteng 31 yang kerap menjadi lokasi strategis bagi berkumpulnya para kader politik muda yang aktif berdiskusi mengenai arah perjuangan bangsa Indonesia.
In Jakarta, his ambition to be a master of laws went hand in hand with his dream to be a nationalist of the independence movement. Chairul Saleh was one of the leading youth figures who represented their ideologies in 1945. He had a radical thought on how the independence would be carried on. He represented the group from Menteng Raya 31 Dormitory, or known as the New Force of Indonesia. It was a vehicle created by Shimizu, who was assigned by the Japanese military government to gather the youth, activists, and the nationalists. They were prepared through courses and education to be deployed to different regions to build nationalism among the people to support Japan in winning the Greater East Asia War.
Namun nurani Chairul Saleh ini terketuk ketika ia menyaksikan bagaimana Jepang dengan brutal menindas begitu banyak penduduk Indonesia, dan ia pun memutuskan untuk melawan Jepang melalui gerakan bawah tanah yang tentu sangat berisiko tinggi bila sampai jejaknya tersebut terendus Jepang.
Chairul Saleh also joined Sendenbu, the Japanese propaganda department, which he masterfully manipulated to serve the interest of Indonesia's independence.
sejak Hairusalem masuk di dalam Sendenbu yang dipimpin sama Shinichi ini, Departemen Propaganda Jepang, justru yang dilakukan oleh Hairusalem itu memanfaatkan institusi Sendenbu ini. Misalnya, bagaimana caranya agar dengan posisi dia sebagai seorang Sendenbu gitu ya, Departemen Propaganda Jepang, dia bisa mempropagandakan bahwa kemerdekaan Indonesia itu harus dilakukan oleh orang Indonesia sendiri tanpa campur tangan Jepang dan harus dilakukan secepat-cepatnya, selekas-lekasnya.
On May 1945, following Germany's defeat in Europe, a youth conference was held by Sendenbu. Keitel was asked to lead the campaign to gather the youth to support Japanese victory in the Greater East Asia War. However, what Keitel did was using the first youth conference in Java during the Japanese time to create an important decree stating that the independence of Indonesia would be carried out immediately and the youth must prepare themselves.
Dia membentuk persatuan pelajar-pelajar Indonesia. Dan itu organisasi pelajar paling radikal di antara semua organisasi pelajar di Indonesia. Itu sudah menunjukkan. Jadi ketika tahun 1939 dia itu tampil di dalam konferensi pemuda di Yogyakarta, itu banyak yang kagum pada Hairusalem karena pidatonya yang memukau dan radikal gitu ya.
Keitel has been organizing the youth since he led Indonesian Students Youth Union in 1940 to 1942. He admired Muhammad Yamin, a senior nationalist who coincidentally originated from the same town with him. Ideas and thoughts about the independence movement were inspired by Yamin. Many of Muhammad Yamin's speeches at Volksrat captivated him, but at the same time, Hairusalem was also close to left-wing ideas as well as its ideologies, like the idea of equality.
Di titik itu kita mungkin bisa menjawab dengan Tan Malaka. Kita tahu Yamin adalah seorang pengagum Tan Malaka, dan kemudian kita juga paham bahwa ketika Tan Malaka terlibat dalam komite pan aksi untuk mengadakan acara di lapangan Ikada tanggal 19 September. Hairusalem adalah tokoh sentral di dalam komite pan aksi ini dan semakin kelihatan nanti setelah peristiwa Ikada, Hairusalem itu ikut bersama Tan Malaka dalam persatuan perjuangan yang menuntut kemerdekaan 100%.
The three of them finally met on the same political stage. After Tan Malaka had been arrested and released, the Murba Party was established in 1948. Hairusalem and Muhammad Yamin were united in this party.
Bapak saya langsung bilang sama saya, "Bin, kita ke Tengku Umar. Ada apa, Pak?" Pak Hairusalem meninggal. Wah, kaget saya.
Arifin Basri was still a 15-year-old middle schooler when Hairusalem was inaugurated as the Minister of Veterans Affairs in Juanda Cabinet in 1956. Before appointed minister, Hairusalem served as Vice Chairman of Veterans Legion of the Republic of Indonesia.
Waktu habis dilantik itu dia datang ke rumah. Bu Hasan, saya habis dilantik jadi Menteri Veteran. Dia dikawal sama perintis itu zaman dulu pakai helm. Helmnya helm coklat, senapan panjang gitu yang jenggel apa-apalah polisi punya itu. Nah, itulah ceritanya. Kalau nama bapak saya berdua tuh bicara-bicara Padang. Ngomong Padang ya Ambo, Awa lah begitulah. Ini memang teman dekat. Dan dia punya, saya ini termasuk penggemar berat. Walaupun sama si anak-anak. Karena saya lihat beliau itu, Khairul Saleh itu keren. Orangnya ganteng, tinggi, tegap, dan berani.
Waktu dia meninggal tuh, Om dengar Ibu Fatmawati jualan kue digoreng itu aja bilang.
Arifin still remembers very well his childhood with Khairul Saleh, who was a close friend of his father, Hasan Basri. Khairul Saleh and Hasan Basri were both freedom fighter veterans. Hasan Basri had even lost a leg in the fight for independence during the battle in Yogyakarta. Hasan Basri then became the chairman of the first Veterans with Disability in Indonesia. Hasan Basri and Khairul Saleh's closeness was also described by Arifin in another story.
Kalau bapak saya bertugas umpamanya di luar negeri mewakili catat veteran untuk Kongres Veteran Sedunia, itu biasanya sampai sebulan itu. Dulu kan pesawat dulu kan nggak ada yang jet itu, dulu masih baling-baling, jadi perjalanan lama itu. Itu kadang-kadang saya disuruh sama ibu saya pergi ke rumahnya Om Khairul Saleh. Disuruh bapak minta uang karena buat belanja lah gitulah ya. Nah, saya ada sama adik saya tuh naik sepeda. Kebetulan dari Gondang Dia ke rumahnya Pak Khairul Saleh itu di Jalan Maringin. Pojokan kalau nggak salah Jalan Lombok apa lupa saya itu. Pokoknya di pojok. Nah, itu udah ditunggu sama Pak Khairul Saleh itu. Oh kamu Bin, ya Om. Sini-sini dong, masuk lah, kasih minum, kasih kue-kue aja.
Before dwelling with veterans, Khairul Saleh was exiled in Germany. He was arrested for denying the result of the roundtable conference that ended with a rebellion in South Banten. He was then imprisoned for 2 years and was exiled to Germany.
Namun ia kemudian ditangkap pada tahun 50 atas tuduhan memberontak dan membuat kacauan sebelum kemudian dibuang ke Jerman. Dan Khairul pun memutuskan untuk meneruskan studinya di Fakultas Hukum di Universitas Bonn di Jerman.
As he returned from Germany, Khairul Saleh's political orientation, which at the beginning referred to Tan Malaka's, later switched to Sukarno's. He was known as Sukarno's close confidant.
Dan waktu itu memang Sukarno sedang membayangkan bagaimana Murba ini bisa menjadi penyeimbang dari PKI. Dan karena itu kemudian Murba bisa ikut pemilu tahun 1955 dan ada wakilnya di dalam Dewan Perwakilan. Dan kemudian kita akan menemukan setelah pemilu tahun 1955, posisi dari orientasi politik Khairul Saleh tidak lagi Tan Malaka, tetapi Sukarno.
At the time, Khairul Saleh filled strategic positions in Sukarno's administration. Besides serving as Minister for Veterans Affairs in the Juanda cabinet, Khairul Saleh also acted as Minister of Energy and Mineral Resources. Khairul also served as Minister for Basic Industry and Mining during the second and the third working cabinet. The climax was in 1963 when he was appointed as third Deputy Prime Minister. At the same time, he was serving as the chairman of the Provincial People's Consultative Assembly from 1960 to 1966.
Ironisnya, ketika 65 meletus, bukan hanya Aidit dari PKI yang diburu dan akhirnya mati, tapi juga Khairul Saleh yang sering berkonflik dan berselisih paham dengan Aidit pun itu diburu dan kemudian ditangkap karena dia dianggap sebagai seorang Soekarnois garis keras. Nah akhirnya ironinya Hairul Saleh itu meninggal di dalam penjara tahanan Orde Baru karena berkait dengan penangkapan dia sebagai orang yang dianggap Soekarnois garis keras di masa awal Orde Baru.
Nah itu bapak saya langsung bilang sama saya, Vin, kita ke Tengku Umar. Ada apa, Pak? Pak Hairul Saleh meninggal. Wah, kaget saya. Saya lihat sendiri jenazahnya. Saya keluar air mata waktu itu. Betul. Begitu saya lihat, sedih saya lihat itu. Seolah-olah meninggalnya itu kok, apa ya, meninggal, kesian lah gitu lah. Orang besar begini kok meninggalnya keadaan begitu. Itu aja ceritanya. Dan saya keluarin mata waktu itu ngeliatnya apa betul. Bapak saya juga bilang, aduh, kasihan.
This was the tragic end of Hairul Saleh's journey, the independence youth who was a radical nationalist. History also highlighted his significant role in the creation of Wawasan Nusantara idea, the Indonesian archipelagic concept, seeing Indonesia as the primary maritime nation.